بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our first lesson going through the book الياقوت النفيس في مذهب ابن إدريس authored by أحمد بن عمر الشاطري who died in the year 1360 after the Hijra and so he lived in the last century. We're in 1442 and he died in the year 1360 and he was born in the year 1312. And so he lived in the last century. And this is our fourth text in our studies in Al-Fiqh Al-Shafi'i. Alhamdulillah, we took Safinat Al-Naja. We then took Al-Mukhtasar Al-Latif or Al-Mukhtasar Al-Saghir by Ba-Fadl. And then we took Mukhtasar Abi Shuja' fi al-Fiqh ala madhhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i. And this is the fourth text, Al-Yaqut Al-Nafis. في مذهب ابن إدريس and we'll see this title in the introduction that the author gives so we'll discuss that, the name of the title of the book there بإذن الله. طيب, without further delay let's get into the كتاب. If you have the book in front of you you can read the biography of the author yourself. He lived in Yemen, تريم. نعم. طيب, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال المصنف الحمد لله على ما شرع من الدين وهدى إلى الصراط المستقيم والصلاة والسلام على الرسول الأمين سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين وصحبه أجمعين. And so here in this first paragraph, the author begins with a basmala, as it's well known etiquette when writing a text. You know, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he would send his letters to the kings of the world, he would begin with the basmala. Now, in the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. And then follow that up with Alhamd, Alhamdulillahi ala ma shara'a min ad-deeni, indeed all praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for ala ma shara'a min ad-deen, for that which he has legislated from the religion. And so this is bara'ati istihlal. Remember, the science that we're discussing here is a science of fiqh, right? And so ala ma shara'a min ad-deen, this is a form of bara'atul istihlal. So bara'atul istihlal is essentially mentioning points that hint at the genre of the work that the book is in. وَهَدَى إِلَى الصِّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. And likewise, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to the clear path. We know the clear path is الطريق الواضح الصراط المستقيم وأن هذا الصراط مستقيما فاتبعوه. Remember, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the straight path. يهدينا الصراط المستقيم. And so we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to this path. And then after that, wassalatu wassalam, to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to exalt the mention and grant peace to al-Rasul, to the Messenger al-Amin. Right? The Messenger of Allah was known as al-Sadiq al-Amin, even before prophethood. Right? And so he is the trustworthy one, alayhi salatu wassalam. Sayyidina, our master, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib al-Hashimi. وآله, and likewise his family, الطاهرين, his pure family. Of course, آل can mean one of two, either أتباع, right, as found in the Quran, أدخلوا آل فرعون أتباع فرعون. So this can mean what, the followers of the Prophet, and it can also refer to specifically the أهل البيت. And أهل البيت are مؤمنو بني هاشم وبني المطلب. So the sons of هاشم and the sons of المطلب, and those are the two sons of عبد مناف, right, these two are considered to be the أهل البيت. وصحبه أجمعين, likewise all of the companions, the entirety of the companions. As we know, a companion is كل من لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مؤمنا به ومات على الإسلام ولو تخللت ردة في الأصح. Right, it is any person who met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, believed in him whilst he was alive and died upon that Islam, even if he became tainted with apostasy, but then he came back to Islam. طيب, and the author, he says أما بعد, to proceed. كلمة انتقال, right, from one point to another. So he went from the introduction of saying Alhamd and Salat and Basmala and so on to now going on to the next point by saying أما بعد فقد أشار علي من لا مندوحة لي في مخالفته ولا مزحل إلا إلى موافقته أن أكتب رسالة في مذهب الإمام الشافعي. And so in this paragraph the author is discussing and outlining the reason why he's writing this work. And so the reason here is that he's been requested, he's been told to write treatise in the madhab, or outlining and discussing the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i. And this person who commanded him or requested from him to do this is none other than his teacher, Abdullah ibn Umar al-Shatiri. Abdullah ibn Umar al-Shatiri. He's the one who requested from Ahmad ibn Umar al-Shatiri to write a booklet in the madhab, or discussing the masail al-fiqhiyya from the lens of the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i. Al-Shafi'i, of course, is Muhammad ibn Idris, ibn Abbas ibn Uthman, ibn Shafi'i, ibn Sa'ib ibn Ubayd, ibn Abdi Yazid, ibn Hashim, ibn al-Muttalib, ibn Abdi Manaf. Right? And Shafi'i is a companion. That's why he's known as al-Shafi'i. So Shafi'i, and along his father, Sa'ib was also a companion as well. But the first grandfather of Imam al-Shafi'i, who was a companion, is Shafi'i, which is why he's known as Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. Naam. الشافعي المطلبي نعم وهو إمام معروف من أئمة أهل السنة والجماعة وهو من مجددي هذه الأمة هو إمام فحل عظيم one of the great imams of the Sunnah one of the great imams of the Salaf born in the year 150 and died in the year 204 so he lived 54 years and he left behind a great legacy رحمة الله عليه طيب and so this method that has remained ever since that period this author, Ahmad ibn Umar al-Shatiri, has been requested from by his teacher, Abdullah ibn Umar al-Shatiri, to write a booklet summarizing the masail al-fiqhiyya within the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i, or from the lens of the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i. And when he says, مَنْ لَا مَنْدُوحَةَ لِي فِي مُخَالَفَتِهِ وَلَا مَزْحَلَ إِلَّا إِلَى مُوَفَقَتِهِ And so he's essentially saying that, that I have no ability, no space to refuse this request, and I have no direction to go except in agreeing with this request. And this is يعني من باب ال it's from the angle of التواضع, right? The angle of humility, right? To his sheikh who requested him, who requested from him to author this kitab. And then he mentioned some of the distinguishing features or some of the key features that we will see within this kitab, and this is what we call براعة المطلب. Right, to mention the positive features of this work by saying جامعة للتعريف حاوية للأركان والشروط مصورة للأنواع خدمة لصغار المتعلمين وتخفيفا لأتعاب المعلمين And so you mentioned that this kitab will be comprising of definitions and it will be gathered together the definitions and this is important So التعريف here is يعني مثلا وزن التفاعيل right it's تفعيل بمع يعني so تعريف تعريف تفعيل and then you pluralize it to ta'arif, tafa'il, right? And so what's meant by this is gathering together the definitions of the key terms. So مثلاً when you go to Babu Salam, right? You want to know what is a Salam? Define for me a Salam both in the Lugha and in the Istilah, right? So how do the Fuqaha define a Salam? How do the Fuqaha define مثلاً al-Ijara? How do the Fuqaha مثلاً define al-Jizya, right? And likewise, what is the linguistic definition of this term as well. So that's what he will do. So it's jami'atan lit-ta'arifi. That's one miza, one distinguishing feature of this kitab. And the second feature is hawiyatan lil-arkani wa shurut. Likewise, every single point that we're going to mention in the masail al-fiqhiyya, we're going to mention the pillars, we're going to mention the conditions, we're going to mention essentially everything that is important for you to be able to do what? Musawwiratan lil-anwa', anything that is important for you to be able to see the picture clearly that this mas'ala is talking about, for you to be able to see it clearly, we're going to bring it, he's going to bring it in this kitab. And of course, this is a fiqh text that gathers together all four sections of fiqh. Remember we said in our previous lesson, in our previous series, that fiqh divides into four parts, right? Al-ibadat, wal-mu'amalat, fiqh al-usra, and babu al-jinayat, wal-qadha, wal-shahadat, wa ma yatba'u dhalik. Right, and so in each section, he's going to mention the masail that are within it, and these masail are going to contain key definitions, and they're going to contain as well the pillars, the shurut. For example, مثلاً كتاب الصلاة, we're going to speak about أركان الصلاة, شروط الصلاة, and so on. Likewise, we're going to talk about نواقض الوضوء مثلاً, or that which breaks the wudu, right? That which breaks your salah, right? We're going to speak about these masail. When, مثلاً, the khutbah, مثلاً, khutbatain, what are the shurut, what are the arkan of the khutbah, and so on. And that's going to be for every single chapter or sub-chapter that the author tackles. طيب. And this is why this book is incredibly liked by the Shafi'iyya of our era. This kitab was written, what? The author died in 1360, right? That's not far It's like around 80 or so years ago, right? And so since then, and this of course is authors, as if you've read the biography of the Sheikh, of this author, he wrote one of the most authoritative shuluh on Safinat al-Najah, Nail al-Raja, bi sharhi Safinat al-Najah. This is the one who authored it, right? And this kitab is, some ulama or some fuqaha from the Shafi'iyya today, they put it ahead of Mukhtasar Abi Shuja, right? And they say this kitab is better for a talib al-ilm, right, before then going into al-Minhaj, that if a person perfects this text, because of the fact that it gathers together for you the definitions and it allows you to see the picture of the mas'al al-fiqhiyya. You read some Shafi'i fiqh texts or other madahib fiqh texts, and you find that even by reading the mas'ala, it doesn't really give you a picture in your head. But the way that he describes the masail makes you picture it very well, right? And the easiest way to learn fiqh is by being able to picture the mas'ala that's been discussed to you. If someone says to you, مثلا, what is as-salam? Right? Describe for me as-salam, مثلا, or describe for me al-ijara. These are terms that you might think, wow, how do I explain it? But the way that the author explains it, if you memorize it, you understand it, it'll allow you to, whenever you hear the word as-salam, the picture that you've made because of reading this text, right, can come into mind straight away, and you can then easily explain, whether it be in your words or verbatim mentioning his words, it makes it a lot easier, right? Which is why this kitab is heavily advised for talabatul ilm to study, especially talabatul ilm who are from the Shafi'i madhab, that they study this kitab, and they make it a primary text for themselves ahead of even Mukhtasar Ibn Shuja, before then, of course, going into the Mu'tamad works. طيب. Now, then the author he says, خدمة لصغار المتعلمين. And again, here this kitab will serve the beginning students of knowledge. وتخفيفا لأتعاب المعلمين. Likewise, will make the job of the teacher quite easy, right? Because the definitions are brought for you, the shurut are brought for you, the arkan are brought for you. So you don't have to go into the shuruh and the hawashi to try to extract the important masail that you need to teach the student, right? When it comes to masail al-fiqhiyya. فسارعت على قصور البين إلى تلبيته فسارعت مع so على بمعنى مع right so I rushed despite my or in spite of my apparent deficiencies in answering this call the call of his teacher وجمعت ما أمكنني جمعه في هذه الوريقات التي سميتها الياقوت النفيس في مذهب ابن إدريس and I gathered together that which is possible for me to gather that which has been made possible for me to gather in these wuraiqat, wuraiqat is a tasghir of waraqat, meaning these short papers, right? These small amount of papers. And then he said that I've labeled or I have named this kitab or this treatise, al-yaqut al-nafis fi madhhab ibn Idris. Al-yaqut al-nafis fi madhhab ibn Idris. And so, what is meant by al-yaqut al-nafis? Al-yaqut, we should know it's a jawhar, a type of jawhar, a type of. Diamond or a type of pearl, right? And a nafis meaning very, very valuable, right? And so he's given us the valuable pearls, the most valuable pearls in the madhab of Ibn Idris, in the madhab of Muhammad Ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. So al-yaqut al-nafis, the expensive, the valuable pearls, right? And yaqut is found in the Quran, right? Surah al-Rahman, right? Al-yaqut wal-marjan, right? And so al-yaqut. النفيس في مذهب ابن إدريس. That's the title of this kitab. Then he says, والمأمول من المطلعين الرضا. And what I hope from those who read this kitab is that they are pleased with it. والإغضاء عما ليس متعين الخطأ. And likewise to overlook that which is not manifestly wrong. So if it's something which isn't apparently incorrect or something which is clear-cut wrong, that they overlook it. So if it's not something that is not clearly wrong, then turn your eyes away from it and overlook it. For example, مثلاً, a little grammar mistake here, or مثلاً, maybe he wrote a sentence in a way that maybe you could write it in a better way than that. Those kind of small little mistakes, overlook it. But if it's متعين, if it's something which is extremely clear, مثلاً, a mas'ala that you make a mistake in where this is not the madhab of Shafi'i, مثلاً, right? Then there's something which you have to make clear. But those kind of mistakes that are مثلاً, imla'i. Mistakes, he wrote it with his hand, so there may have been those kind of mistakes. Although this kitab is muhaqqaq, right? And there isn't many. طيب, and we can overlook it. والإغضاء عما ليس متعين الخطأ. Likewise, مثلا, sometimes you have a def he gives a definition. مثلا, we'll see it إن شاء الله in كتاب الطهارة, right? The definition that he gives for الطهارة, maybe you can give a better one than that, the one that he gave, right? But that's something which can be overlooked. ومن المولى سبحانه والإثابة والقبول. Likewise, he asks from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he hopes that he receives from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-ithabat wal-qabul, reward for the action that he's done and acceptance of the action that he has done. طيب. Then the author, he says muqaddimah or muqaddamah, an introduction. So now he's gone from that initial point of introduction, which is to essentially come with the basmala, the hamdala, salat ala nabi, sallallahu mentioned why he's writing this work, what are the positive features of this kitab, and what he hopes to gain from this kitab. Now he goes on to giving us a brief little introduction, muqaddimah or muqaddamah. Right, you can say both. He says, اعلم, have knowledge, أنه ينبغي لكل شارع في فن, that anybody who goes into a science, so now you want to begin studying a science or begin studying a field, right, or a text in a science or a text in a field, أن يعرف مبادئه العشرة, you have to know its 10 introductory principles, right, that the science is based upon. And this is يعني taken from the line of poetry, إن مبادئ كل فن عشرة. And what are these 10 points? وهي حده وموضوعه وفائدته ومسائله واسمه واستمداده وحكم الشارع فيه ونسبته إلى سائر العلوم وفضله وواضعه. You have to know its definition. So this science that I'm going into, what is it? How is it defined? وموضوعه, what is the subject matter? Likewise, وفائدته, what's the benefit that I gain from studying this? ومسائله, what are the issues that are tackled in this science? وإسمه, what's the name of this science? واستمداده, where is this science rooted from, right? Where is the science taken from, right? وحكم الشارع فيه, what is the ruling of the Sharia with regards to studying this science? ونسبته إلى سائر العلوم, with regards to the other علوم, what is the link, or how does this science fare compared to the other sciences? Is it similar to it or is it different from it? وفضله, what is the virtue of studying this science? And so there is an inherent virtue of studying the science, and then there's فائدة, which is the benefit that you gain from studying the science. وواضعه, who are the ones who put down this science? Who are the originators in this science? طيب. والفن الذي نحن بصدده الفقه. He says that the science that we're going to be studying is, or the science that I'm writing in, is الفقه. It is al-fiqh. And so we're going to be defining al-fiqh, mentioning the subject matter of al-fiqh, the fa'id of studying fiqh, the masail of fiqh, the ism, what's the name of the science, where is the science rooted from, what is the ruling of studying fiqh, how does fiqh stand aside the other, or stand along with the other sciences, is it similar to it, is it different from it, and so on. وفضله, what is its virtue, and who was the one who put down the science of fiqh. So then he begins with a definition, and we studied the definition of fiqh in our usul classes, so we don't really have to go into it in detail. It should be well known to us. العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المكتسب من أدلتها التفصيلية. So it's something which we should know. We've discussed it before. طيب, in our usul classes. So the حد of العلم, someone asks you how to define fiqh. You say الفقه هو العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المكتسبة من أدلتها التفصيلية. نعم. موضوعه, what is the subject matter of الفقه, أفعال المكلفين. So the subject matter is the actions of the responsible ones, or those who are held accountable. And who is the مكلف, البالغ العاقل. البالغ العاقل. So the one who is held accountable usually is the one who is what? Past the age of puberty and is of sane mind. طيب. And so we combine those two terms by using the word التكليف, حد التكليف أو المكلف. So we're talking about the actions of the one who is held responsible. That is the subject matter of fiqh. وفائدته, what's the benefit? امتثال الأوامر واجتناب النواهي. The benefit that one gains from studying fiqh is that he's able to what? Come with the command, abide by the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and stay away and avoid the prohibitions. So you come with what? The commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfilling them. Right, be they of course the wajib and the mandub, and al-awamir can be what? Either a wajib or a sunnah, right? And ijtinabun nawahi, right? Ijtinabun nawahi is going to be of course the muharram and the makruh, and then you have the mubah, which is yani in the middle. طيب. And so we have the fa'idah, the benefit of studying fiqh, that you know what's wajib upon you, what's mandub upon you, what's mubah for you, what's haram upon you, and what's makruh for you to do. طيب. So that's the primary benefit that a person gains from studying fiqh. ومسائله. What does the what is the issues, what are the issues that Fiqh deals with? He says هي القضايا التي تذكر فيه. So المسائل is the issues. So the مسائل of Fiqh are the issues that are discussed within it. كتاب الصلاة, كتاب الزكاة, كتاب الصيام, كتاب الحج. Issues pertaining to الصلاة, زكاة, صيام, حج. Essentially those four sections we mentioned earlier. Right? The عبادات, the معاملات, the Fiqh الأسرة, the family Fiqh, the issues of family Fiqh, الطلاق, النكاح, and so on. Right, and then we have the jinayat and the qada and the da'awa and the shahadat and so on. طيب وما يتبع ذلك. طيب واسمه, what is the name of the science? علم الفقه. We call it علم الفقه. طيب واستمداده, where does علم الفقه have its roots? In the kitab, the Quran, in the sunnah, which is of course أقوال النبي وأفعال النبي وتقريرات النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Of course, the muhaddithin adon wa sifatihi al-khilqiyyati wal-khuluqiyya. Wal-ijma' likewise, the consensus wa al-qiyas, which is the analogic reasoning. Al-ijma' of course is, we took it in our usul classes, ittifaq mujtahidi al-ummah, qawlan aw fi'lan aw taqreera, ba'da wafati al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fi asrin, in a specific era, ala amrin shar'i, ala amrin muta'alliqin bil-shari'ah. Naam. And so that is al-ijma'. And al-qiyas, of course, is the analogic reasoning, right? Al-qiyas هو حمل أمر معلوم على مثله لمساواته له في علة حكمه, right? And the classic example that is given for the qiyas is, مثلا, you have the prohibition in the Quran, right? So you have an asl and a far', right? So the asl is a prohibition, it's a مثلا, in the example we give, the prohibition of eating, unlawfully eating the wealth of the orphan one. Right, we know that that is haram. ولا تأكلوا أموال اليتامى إن قال الله تعالى ولا تأكلوا أموالكم بينك ولا تأكلوا أموال اليتامى. سورة النساء, in سورة النساء, the prohibition of eating the wealth of the poor, or eating the wealth of the orphan, I should say. Right, now, does that mean I am allowed to burn the wealth of the orphan? لا. However, this point of burning the wealth of the orphan, is it found in the Quran? لا. So this is the far'. So the asr, they're not allowed to consume the wealth of the orphan, in terms of you actually consuming yourself, eating it and taking it and using it for yourself. طيب. However, does that mean I'm allowed to just burn it, مثلا, put it in the fire? Right? لا. This is the far'. Although this hukum, right, which is burning the wealth of the orphan, it's something which is not explicitly mentioned in the Kitab or the Sunnah, the illah that it has, the effective cause, which is al-itlaf, you're destroying the wealth of the orphan, and the illah for why eating or consuming the wealth of the orphan was made haram is the same. So the illah behind consuming the wealth of the orphan unjustly is that you've destroyed it, right, and you've taken it away from the orphan. Likewise here, when you burn the wealth of the orphan unjustly, you are taking away his wealth, and so you have destroyed his wealth. And so the illah here is the same. The cause, the effective cause, is the same. And so we say that the far' is attached to the asl, even though the far' is not found in explicitly mentioned in the Quran or the Sunnah. That's basically al-qiyas. And the classic example is given with regard to al-khamr and vodka. Vodka is something which is not mentioned in the Kitab or the Sunnah, but it has the same illah as al-khamr, right? As same illah as al-khamr. Al-khamr means wine, right? In terms of when you look at al-khamr linguistically, the early Arabs linguistically used the word al-khamr to mean what? The wine that's made from grapes. The wine derived from grapes. And so vodka, or مثلا, wine that's derived from wheat, مثلا, they didn't call it khamr. طيب. And so this is a far'. The vodka is a far'. And the khamr is the asl. Right, and so we say the illah is the same. The illah is the same, which is what al-iskar, right? And so therefore we say that the hukum, which is tahrim al-khamr, also falls upon the far', which is tahrim vodka. طيب. So that's al-qiyas in brief, and we spoke about this in more detail in our usul classes. طيب. وحكم الشريعة فيه, what is the ruling of the sharia with regard to al-fiqh? We can divide it into three parts. We have wajib aini, wajib kifai, and nadb. So there's some part of fiqh which is an individual obligation for everybody to learn. So the sharia states that there are certain parts of fiqh that is obligatory for everybody to learn. And then we have al-kifai, which is that there are some parts of fiqh which are obliged upon the community as a whole, but not on every single person individually. Meaning the community must come with it, but يعني it's not an in, it's not in, it's not wajib upon every single individual person, as long as of course the community comes with it. And so it's what فرض كفاية. فرض كفاية, communal obligation. Meaning if some of the community comes with it, سقط الإثم عن الباقي. طيب, if some of the community comes with it, the sin is uplifted from the rest of the people. والندب, then there's a section of fiqh which is recommended for you to learn. Meaning it's what يثاب على فعله ولا يعاقب على تركه. نعم. And so what are the أحكام, or what is the part of fiqh which is obligatory individually for everybody to learn? That is فيما تتوقف عليه صحة العبادة والمعاملة والمناكحة. Anything that is required in order for you to come with a valid act of worship, or a valid transaction, or a valid marriage, right? Then you have to learn it. So now if I want to pray, I need to know those things that will enable me to have a valid prayer. طيب. And so I need to know the arkan, the shurut, right? Likewise, those things that break my salah, right? I need to know these things, طيب, in order for my salah to be valid. Likewise, I want to now open up a business. I need to know everything that everything that is required for my business to be considered valid, for my transactions to be deemed valid. Likewise, I want to get married, right? I have to know everything that will make sure that my marriage is valid and that my marriage stays valid. So anything that needs to be, anything that has conditions and has a form of level that you need to reach in order for it to be deemed valid, you need to know how to reach that level and what it is you need to get to that level. طيب. I.e. having a valid act of worship, having a valid transaction, or having a valid business, right, and having a valid marriage. مثلا. طيب. You have to know these things. So مثلا, a person wants to pay zakat, he has to know everything to do with ensuring that zakat is valid. So anything that will make sure that this zakat is valid, that is zakat that I have done, this act of worship that I have done, is valid, meaning it is sahih, siha, طيب, then I have to know it. I have to know it. طيب. And that is what is fardu ayn. That is what is fardu ayn. طيب. And so that's why, generally speaking, abwab al-ibadat are, because these are acts of worship that we do regularly, right, and most of mankind, or most of the Muslimin do it, it's obligatory for us to learn. طيب. مثلا, I'm going to Hajj this year, and I've never gone to Hajj before. I have to learn what will make me have a valid Hajj before I get to performing the Hajj, right? And so before I start performing the Hajj, I need to know what it is that I have to do to ensure that I get a valid Hajj. I have to know it. That's a fard ayn. طيب, it's an individual obligation. طيب. It doesn't mean that when it comes to مثلا كتاب الحج مثلا, because it's obligatory for a person once in a lifetime, and مثلا this year you don't have the ability to make the Hajj, do I have to learn Hajj this year? لا, right? That falls under الواجب الكفائي. الواجب الكفائي, right? But when you are now going to go to the Hajj, and you are intending to go to the Hajj, and now this is the year that you're going to go to the Hajj, it becomes now فرض عين. It becomes فرض عين upon you. Why? Because in order for you to get a valid Hajj, there are certain things you have to know. You have to know what makes the Hajj, or what do I need to do to ensure that the Hajj is valid. And likewise, you can do that for the rest of the acts of worship and the rest of the acts that a person performs. طيب. And مثلا, the reason why we study the Salah regularly, right, is because the Salah is a daily act, right? The Salah is a daily act. طيب. And so you have to know what is required from you in order to have a valid Salah. We just came out of the month of Ramadan, right? And so when it comes to the month of Ramadan, it's a yearly thing. And so when the month of Ramadan comes, you need to be able to know, have studied, that which will enable you to have a valid fast. Now, when wal-kifai, the wal-kifai is the second level, which is the communal obligation. فِيمَا زَادَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ إِلَى بُلُوغِ دَرَجَةِ الْفَتْوَىٰ. Anything that is beyond the level of wajib al-ayni, until you reach the level of being a mufti, anything between that, so the minimum level of al-wajib al-kifai is anything above that which is what? Wajib ayni. So you have wajib ayni, which is the base. Anything above wajib ayni becomes wajib kifai until you reach what? Darajat al-fatwa. Darajat al-fatwa. And the reason why is because we need muftis in the ummah. It's obligatory for us to have people who know the religion. فلولا نفر من كل فرقة طائفة ليتفقهوا في الدين ولينذروا قومهم إذا رجعوا إليهم لعلهم يحذرون. We need individuals who have taken the time out to study the religion and reach the level where they are able to give fatwa. Where they are able to give fatwa, meaning answer the questions of the people. طيب. And then we have الندب. الندب is فيما زاد على ذلك. Anything that is from the مسائل الفقهية beyond what a person needs to become a mufti, right? Then that is considered sunnah for you to learn. Right? It's not wajib kifai nor is it wajib aini. So we have here حكم الشارع three levels. Al-wajib al-aini, that which is an individual obligation. Al-wajib al-kifai, that which is a communal obligation. And al-nadb, that which is a sunnah. Naam. Then the author, he said, وَنِسْبَتُ إِلَى سَائِرِ الْعُلُومِ. As for the link that that the science of fiqh has with the other sciences, it is al-mughayaratu laha. It is completely different from it. So the other sciences like nahw and tafsir and sarf and balagha and sira, these sciences, they don't deal with the topics that fiqh deals with. Fiqh deals with wajib, muharram, mandub, makruh, right, mubah. That's what fiqh deals with. But when you're studying nahw, you don't learn what is يعني, haram, what is wajib. لا, you don't learn that. طيب, and so it's completely different. طيب. Although the other sciences serve fiqh, right? Fiqh is min ulum al-ghayat. So when we talk about al-ulum, ilm al-shar'i, we divide it into two parts. We have ilm al-ghaya and we have ilm wasila, right? And so the ulum al-wasail, like مثلاً النحو, صرف, بلاغة, right? قراءات, and so on. These are ulum ghaya, ulum wasila, ulum wasail. These are ulum that are wasail. They are tools that you need in order to serve the ulum al-ghaya. Ulum al-ghaya is aqidah, fiqh, tafsir, and hadith, right? These are the four sciences that are considered the objective knowledge, right? Whereas supplementary knowledge or instrumental knowledge is the ulum al-wasail. And so fiqh is from the ulum al-maqasid or ulum al-ghayat. طيب. وفضله, what is the virtue of studying fiqh? فوقانه على سائر العلوم. The fadl of studying fiqh, meaning the inherent virtue within fiqh, is that it is above the other sciences. It's min ulum al-ghayat. Right? It's min ulum al-ghayat. نعم. So it's not a wasila, it's a ghaya itself. طيب, علم الفقه. ووضعه, who are the ones who put down علم الفقه؟ الأئمة المجتهدون. الأئمة, the imams that have reached the level of اجتهاد. Like الشافعي, رحمة الله عليه, and of course those who came before him as well. Right? From the Salaf الصالح, from the Sahaba first and foremost. Right? The فقهاء, the Sahaba, like Ibn Mas'ud, and Umar al-Khattab, and Abu Bakr, and Ibn Abbas. Right? And so on, right? And then you come down to the level of the tabi'een, right? Al-fuqaha al-sab'a, right? You have Imam Malik, Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, right? Ashab al-madahib, right? These are the al-aimah al-mujtahidun, right? As for, of course, the fadl, the evidence for that is the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. The hadith of Muawiyah, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. He whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for, will give him an understanding of the religion. Likewise, the dua, the Messenger of Allah, may Ibn Abbas, Allahumma faqqihu fi al-deen wa 'allimhu at-ta'wil. Allahumma faqqihu fi al-deen wa 'allimhu at-ta'wil. And so the wadi', those who put down ilm al-fiqh, are the a'immah al-mujtahidun. A'immah al-mujtahidun. And these a'immah al-mujtahidun include, as I mentioned, the likes of al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, who is of course one of the great imams of the Salaf al-Salihun. طيب, and of course before him as well you had the jeel of the tatba'u tabi'een and the tabi'een and the sahaba, they are all also from the a'immah al-mujtahidun. طيب, with that we're able to finish this lesson, and so we'll stop here بإذن الله. We'll begin with kitab al-tahara in the next lesson. طيب, هذا والله أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك, والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.